Today we're reading Chapter 9, Skeleton Houses. Skeleton houses are not, as some people might suppose, houses chock full of skeletons. They are new houses being built and at that stage where only the wooden framework has been erected. When the wood was getting low in the wood bin, Rachel and Jerry would listen for the sound of hammering and pounding echoing through the quiet cold of the winter day in Cranberry, telling them that a new house was being built. Then off they would go with their express wagon or their sleds to the skeleton house and pile these high with chunks of brand new wood to start fire in the kitchen range. This was turning out to be a very cold winter, but so far, and it was almost Christmas, there had been very little snow. It was so cold for a few days that the harbor froze over entirely, something that had happened only once that Mama could remember. It was very exciting, and if you wanted, you could get from Cranberry to the city by ice boat. "It's like Holland!" yelled Rachel delightfully when she looked out of Papa's high tower window one day and saw in the distance ice boats the boys had made sailing swiftly over the harbor. Keeping the wood bin full was Jerry and Rachel's special job. What was the sense of buying wood when, with a little ingenuity, plenty of it could be found? Ordinarily, Jerry and Rachel were able to keep the wood bin filled with driftwood gathered along the shore. But now, with all the ice in the harbor, naturally there was no wood drifting in, and they had to think of other places to find it. Next to the shore, the most important place for finding kindling was in skeleton houses. Because there had been so little snow, building on the new houses had not stopped, and the wood bin was almost never empty. The children always went to the skeleton houses after the carpenters had left, or on Saturdays and Sundays, in order not to be in the way. Naturally, the children did not take the great big pieces of wood, only small pieces of planks and shavings that the carpenters were happy to have cleared away. They had wonderful times in the skeleton houses, climbing all over them, even up to the second floor that was not yet a floor yet at all, but was merely great beams stretched across where the floor was going to be. They were such good climbers, they never fell down and broke a leg or anything. However, when a new house reached the plastering stage, they could no longer go in. They used to go in the plastering houses too, but in one of these, Rachel had rubbed against the wet plaster and had practically ruined her coat. Here's a picture of them climbing on the rafters. This was a brand new bright red coat that Mama had made for her, and the plaster turned the coat from red to orange in spots. It looked awful. Mama didn't scold, but then Mama never scolded. However, she did suggest that hereafter, when a skeleton house was in the plastering stage, they better not go inside of it. Just stay on the outside. Staying on the outside was not such fun, but they stuck to the rule and went in only into skeleton houses that had not had the plaster on them yet. And so they ruined no more coats. One cold evening, Rachel and Jerry went to a skeleton house way over on 2nd Avenue, the street of Wally Bullwinkle and the mysterious footstepper. Even though the plastering had not been begun on this skeleton house, since it was dark, they naturally did not go in, lest they slip off a beam into the deep, dark, dank cellar. Instead, they stumbled around in the dark where the porch was going to be. They had very good pickings that night, for they got here before anyone else. Even before the Moffats, who knew about skeleton houses for wood and who ordinarily were the first on the scene. They soon had their wagon loaded high. On these trips to skeleton houses, they always kept their eyes open for signs of Ginger Pie and still kept calling him. They were always thinking of Ginger and speaking of him and remembering him. Even though it was almost Christmas, they were not likely to forget their puppy, especially Jerry, whose particular pet Ginger Pie was. Rachel was not likely to forget either, since she had just about the best memory of anybody in the whole Pie family. Rachel remembered things that had happened before she was two. She remembered the house they had lived in when she was about one that was near the railroad tracks, and she remembered the trains, New York to Boston, streaking past with a sudden roar. She also remembered about Aletta Livingston, who had lived next door to that old house. Aletta was also about 1 year old when she looked out her window at Rachel, and Rachel often looked out hers at Aletta. Of course, with a memory like that, Rachel would not be likely to forget about Ginger ever. And now, as they were tying rope around their wood to keep it steady and drawing on their mittens, she said, "Remember, Jerry? This is just about where we heard the first mysterious footsteps." Naturally, Jerry remembered this too, though he didn't remember anything before he was two the way Rachel did. In fact, a lady had once asked him what was the first thing he remembered, and he said he didn't know he was alive until he was 5. Now, ready to leave for home, the children stood silently for a moment. It was strange how, whenever they were in this part of Cranberry, they thought most keenly about Ginger. Perhaps this was because of the memory of the footsteps. Anyway, it really seemed to them that they might be nearer Ginger here than anywhere else. In spite of Wally Bullwinkle's warning to stay away from here and the memory of Bit-Nosed Ned, they came and called and searched up and down Second Avenue more often than any other street in town. They were very lucky that this new skeleton house was going up here where, somehow, they felt nearest to Ginger. They could pay frequent visits to the new house, and Wally Bullwinkle, as well as all the other people who lived over here, would not wonder at seeing them around so often. All these people would see and hear the new house being built. They would see Rachel and Jerry. They would see the wagon full of shavings and wood, and they would think that it was natural. At the same time as getting wood, the children would try to find their dog all over again. Here's a picture of Rachel when she was looking out the window at her friend Aletta when she was only 1 year old. These people and Wally would realize that you don't look once for a lost dog and then give up and never look or call again. Yes, the new house gave them an excellent excuse to knock on doors over here all over again asking people about Ginger. However, they would try to avoid not only Wally's door, but the door of a certain woman they called Mincemeat. One night, when Jerry and Rachel had been desperately knocking on doors, asking people if they had seen Ginger, a woman came to the door before they could even get a sentence out about Ginger. She held up her hands and said, "I'm making mincemeat. Can't you see I'm making mincemeat?" And she slammed the door in their faces. Her hands hadn't had any mincemeat on them that they could see, but the way she held them up and the way she said mincemeat made them imagine that they were just dripping in it. So they had called her mincemeat from then on. One reason they kept knocking at doors, asking people if they had seen Ginger, was that they hoped to glimpse the old yellow hat hanging on a peg in the hallway. Of course, they could not be positive that the person who had stolen Ginger had anything to do with the person in the old felt hat or the mysterious footprints, but lacking any other clues, they persisted in thinking so. Well, now their wood was all loaded and their mittens were on and their overcoats were buttoned up tight, and still they stood and listened in the vast dark night. The wonderful smell of new wood was in their nostrils, and also the dank smell of black earth from the cellar recently dug. Often, on Ginger searching expeditions, Rachel and Jerry stood still as mice. Naturally, if they made a whole lot of noise and called every minute, how would they be able to hear Ginger when he barked or whined, letting them know where he was? This was one of their listening periods. In fact, this whole trip was more of a listening than a calling trip. It was so quiet they would have felt funny breaking the quietness with their voices. It would be just as though the world would shake in half if they called just once. Their ears rang with the quiet. Then, in the quiet, Jerry thought he heard a dog yelping. But at the same moment, Rachel, because the stillness was making her feel spooky, to break the spell, called suddenly, "Here, Ginger, Ginger, Ginger! Here, Ginger Pup!" And Jerry heard the dog no more. "Shh, shh, shh," said Jerry, grabbing Rachel's arms. "I thought I heard a dog yelping. It could have been Ginger. It didn't sound far away, either." There was no more yelping, however, and though they called and whistled and coaxed until they were hoarse, and then listened hard, nothing but stillness answered them. Jerry didn't even know from what direction the bark had come. Cold and downcast, they carefully, not to spill any, lugged their wagon load of wood out of the lumpy yard of the new skeleton house. Then, as they turned onto the sideway, in the dark, whom should they encounter but the man in the yellow hat? They couldn't help gasping in terror and surprise. But wait! On second sight, they saw it was not their man in the yellow hat at all. It was just Wally Bullwinkle, the boy in Jerry's class, and he simply had the same sort of hat as Unsavory, that was all. Oh, they were relieved. This was not their Unsavory character that they had drawn a picture of and posted in the Rogues Gallery at the town hall and put in their funny papers as a villain. This was only Wally Bullwinkle, owner of the dog as ferocious as the one they had heard about that had bit the nose off of Bit-Nosed Ned. Wally stood in their path, and Jerry and Rachel smiled at him. They were so glad to see him and not the real Unsavory. No, they would not care to encounter the real unsavory at all by themselves over here on Second Avenue, even though they were fairly close to a streetlight and not an awfully long way from the house of Judge Ball, the most important man in Cranberry. It would be hard to think of a more important man than Judge Ball in Cranberry, and they had dusted his pew once, whether he knew it or not. Wally did not seem glad to see them, as they were to see him. He didn't return their smile. And then, on third sight, they saw that Wally didn't have a yellow hat on after all. He had no hat on. He was bareheaded. Were they just so eager to see the yellow hat that they had begun imagining they saw the yellow hat every place? That's what they wondered. Wally snarled, "What are you doing over here? What are you snooping around over here for? Didn't I tell you I'd seek my hound on you if I ever caught you over here?" "We're not snooping. We're getting wood, and we're looking for our dog," said Rachel indignantly. Jerry clenched his fists. He was not the sort of boy to ever say ouch, and now he was trying to remember the 1-2-3s of self-protection that tall Sam Duty had taught him. It looked as though he might have to put his knowledge into effect for the first time on Wally Bullwinkle. But Wally didn't give Jerry a chance to even warm up. He gave their wood a good kick so they would have to gather it and pile it up again. Then he raced off towards his house a few doors up the street. He was gone. "He's mean," said Rachel as they stacked the new wood up again. There's the picture. And can you see Wally in the distance? Jerry said nothing. He couldn't understand what he'd gotten into Wally. What did he have to ask like that for? That was what Jerry wondered. "I thought he had a yellow hat on when I first saw him," said Jerry.
"I did too," said Rachel.
"But he didn't have a hat on at all," said Jerry.
"Unless he threw it in the bushes," said Rachel.
"I didn't see him flip it or pick it up or anything," said Jerry, puzzled.
"You know what?" said Rachel. "I think there's a society of mean people who wear funny yellow hats. Unsavory is one of them, and perhaps the head man. And Wally Bullwinkle makes two. There may be others."
"Jiminy Cricket," said Jerry, appalled at the possibility. "Still," he said, "we will always know our yellow hat from all the others because of the mark Dick Badger put in it."
"Yes," said Rachel, "unless, as in the tinderbox, the mean people with the yellow hats have the sense to put red marks in all of them. The way to tell have they done this or not is for you to look in Wally's hat if he ever wears it to school and hangs it on a peg. If he has a yellow hat, that is. If his yellow hat has a red mark in it, you'll know that all the yellow hat people have done the same thing, put red marks in their hats to throw us off the track. But you can try to get it out of Wally, who the head man unsavory is."
"Oh," said Jerry tiredly, "that's fairy tale stuff." He was remembering the poisoned tomatoes and Rachel's unreasonable reasonableness, and he was reminding himself, the earnest way she was talking, that he should be on guard. As they turned down Second Avenue, starting for home, a little terrier, black and white and full grown, came running out of a yard barking at them. No doubt this was the dog Jerry had heard before, they thought dolefully. Perhaps here they were, spending all their time looking for Ginger over in this part of town, when all the while he might be over in a completely different section. Hereafter, they would think of new and far places to go and stretch and search.
"You know," said Rachel, "Ginger came to be a member of the family on Labor Day, or just before Labor Day, anyway. He found you in school the day before Columbus Day. He was stolen on Thanksgiving Day. Maybe he'll come home on Christmas Day. Maybe he is sort of a holiday dog."
Said Jerry. Christmas was not far away, but it was too far to consider Ginger being gone all that time more. In silence, they left the skeleton house far behind and went home with their wood, their breath blowing behind them in gusts in the crisp, fresh wind that had arisen. The wind, at any rate, broke the silence and set dry boughs creaking and bending and the sign in front of the drugstore swaying and rocking on its hinges. "There might be something in what Rachel said, a holiday dog," thought Jerry. He could see no catch in that. He might come home for Christmas. He might. When they reached home, they had got out one of their drawings of Unsavory the Villain. They had colored his hat yellow, as they did in all the pictures. Now they wished the person they had seen tonight had been the real villain instead of Wally, just a boy in Jerry's class. If it had been Unsavory, they might have their puppy back by now. To think there was more than one yellow hat in this sort of town. If Wally had a yellow hat on, that is, it wasn't a case of just their having yellow hats on the brain. Then they would have one less clue.
In fact, the only clue they would have left then, aside from their drawing, was the red mark Dick Badger had put in the real hat. Even at that, Wally might have been playing around at the res all day, and Dick might have put the red mark in his hat and not the hat of Unsavory at all. Well, as Rachel suggested, the way to tell whether it had been Wally or not, and not the real Unsavory at the res, was for Jerry, the first chance he got, to examine Wally's yellow hat. If Wally did have a yellow hat, that is, and it was not a case of hats on the brain tonight. That's what they decided to do. They told one another as they got out their papers and pencils and crayons, pushed everything off the square dining room table, and began to draw a new funny paper of the Unsavory character. In this one, they had him being the head man of a band of yellow hat mean men, as Rachel had suggested he might be. And in the distance, the Secret Service men were coming. That's all for today. Love you.